Let us pray. Father, thank you, Jesus, for your grace. Thank you for blessing Donna with that document, Lord, and for opening her eyes to see that it is from you. Lord, what a blessing. We pray for Sharon, that you would heal her headache, Lord, and you would make it go away. We pray for Andrea, whatever she is going through, that you would heal her. And Donna, Beatrice, Lord, pray that she all is well with her. Father God, there's so much natural disasters in our world today. May this be a wake-up call so those who don't know you don't recognize your power. Those who need to turn to you will learn to turn to you, depend on you, and put their hope in you, Jesus. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you that you came on that first Easter to reveal yourself to us. Nobody asked you, Lord, but you chose out of your love to come and sacrifice your own self for all our sins, Lord. We give you thanks, Jesus. Forgive us for not recognizing this every day. And remind us, Lord, to share this with others so that they too will receive your grace and your forgiveness and your eternal salvation, Lord. And now, Lord, open our hearts and our minds so that we will receive your word, that your word will fall on fertile ground, Lord, that we will be nourished and that we will receive nourishment to nourish others. We lift up my good friend and brother in Christ, Franklin, and his sons and daughter-in-laws and his grandchildren and Angela's siblings. Lord, bless them, give them peace and comfort as they send her away. And we pray that her soul is with you, Lord. And those who remain will have the knowledge and the belief that one day, we shall all meet again. And what a day of rejoicing that will be. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So, my friends, tonight, you notice how Parker put this together. You know, the love of God. Oh, here comes Beatrice. Oh, I need to assign some more Bible verses. Donna? Matthew 7:7. Hartley, Mark 11:24. Mark 11:24. Let me pause this. And you know, we've learned about the greatness of God. We've known about the importance of knowing God. We've known that God knows us and that we should know him. We've known about that he's unchanging. He's sincere. He is the truth. We've learned about the love of God. In fact, next week, we're going to learn about the love of God. Sorry, last week, we did the love of God. Next week, we're going to learn about God the judge. So I hope that you are really getting some value out of this study. Yeah. And that your faith is being nourished. And that you believe in the almighty, incarnate, God is getting stronger and stronger. So anybody would like to share, how is this impacting you in your walk with Jesus? Or is not impacting you?
Really, this Bible study gives joy, Dad. I learning more and more about theology, Dad. Really, it is very useful to me, Dad. Really.
Thank you. I don't believe in information dumping and doing things for doing sake, checking a box. We went to a Bible study. It's got to have a purpose. And the purpose is to nourish our souls and to grow in our faith. Anybody else would like to share? How is this impacting you? What are you getting out of this?
For me, it is some repetition, but it is broadening one's perspective of so it's adding to what I might have encountered already.
Thank you. How about you, Donna?
Hmm?
How is this, what is this doing for you, this study?
It has opened my eyes to things I never knew before, and has broadened my perspective, and it has increased my faith tremendously. My
Amen.
Faith has grown exponentially, as they say in prayer.
Yeah.
My faith has grown. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. How about you, Jerry? Has this helped you in any way?
Yeah, well, I have gotten a lot of new perspectives, as somebody used the word perspective before. But it has increased my knowledge of God and his various attributes. You know, like last week we dealt with love, we're dealing with grace this week and so on. And I am aware that the late G.I. Packer is a prominent evangelical scholar who has been contributing throughout his life, you know, in this way. So he has given me some different ways of looking at God and all the attributes of God, as I said, and how it is reflected in the scripture, you know, all the scriptural references and so on. So
thank you.
I think I enjoyed it, especially when we reach the last chapter, how he crystallizes everything. You know.
All right. Beatrice, unmute.
Okay, for me, it's given the Bible, you know, the word life, because I'm comparing it to everyday happenings, and, you know, it's more meaningful to me, that life is more meaningful, understanding the word. And putting it, you know, in with real life situations. So it gets, it makes me think a lot.
Amen.
What's happening in front of me and everything that happened that is wonderful. You know, I try to find somewhere, you know, to reference, to compare it with what is happening in the world, you know?
Amen.
Did I mention that I got water? That I told you that.
Yeah, you told us you got water. Your son did some research and got it fixed. And amen. All is good. All is good. For me, this is the fifth time I'm teaching this book. It's the first time I'm teaching it online. And every time I do it, I get more. It's like the Bible. Every time you read it, you get more. But for me personally, it's creating a greater awareness of the presence and the love and the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's giving me more strength and confidence in stepping out of the boat. You won't believe some of the things that he has told me to do. Just to give you an example, I will be driving down the road and I'll see a cop park up on the, you know, they always park on the side of the road looking for whatever they're looking for. And he will say, go pray. He will say, go pray for that cop. And I will go and pull alongside the guy and he will roll down his window. And I will say, sir, what's your name? And my name is Lincoln. Would you mind if I pray with you? And so far, everyone, I said, yes, and you should see the smile on their face. You should see, you know, and that's just one example of being obedient to this almighty God and serving him in everything that you do, in every single thing that you do to serve him. and glorify him in everything that you do. So tonight, our study is the grace of God, to understand the doctrine of grace. And we all know that famous hymn, Amazing Grace. So let me play it for you. Just as a reminder, share sound, very good.
The story behind this same hymn is a great one.
All right. Come on. Okay, that's what I want. Sing along. I tell you, the sound of that violin is so soothing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Isn't it? You know,
yes, yeah.
David played the harp. Amazing grace. It's amazing. And I hope when we receive it, we will acknowledge it as being amazing. So What's your understanding of the grace of God? When you think about the grace of God, what do you understand by that?
That God is pouring himself out, full of compassion and mercy upon sinners.
Anybody else?
Bringing them to him.
I think that even though you are doing something wrong, that God will still listen to you and be merciful and help you.
That is a good example of grace, yeah?
I just think of mercy.
Mercy
and forgiveness from my Father. Yeah? Mm. My Father.
Amen. Amen. Jerry, you're going to say something.
Yeah, so I found this is in Exodus when the Lord was speaking to Moses on the mountain. And then let me read it. The Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation. Yeah, this is what the Lord was telling Moses, you know, sum up his, what his character was. Yeah, that's it.
So what's your understanding of grace?
Well, some of the adjectives we have is that he's a gracious God.
Gracious God.
He's compassionate. He's slow to anger. He's abounding in love and faithfulness.
All right. Thank you. Reverend Joseph, what about you? What's your understanding of grace?
Yes, Ted. Grace is God's asset. Grace is God's asset. He can give to his people.
Amen. I remember the acronym. I think I shared this with you in the past. GRACE, God's riches, all of his riches at Christ's expense. And it kind of wraps up what all of you have said. He freely give to us. Nobody asked Jesus to come. His Father sent him and he didn't retaliate. He didn't say why. He didn't say, I'm not going to go, and then change his mind. He went, he came willingly in obedience to his Father and out of love for us. And when I think about grace, I think about, and we've studied this, the fruit of the Spirit. Donna, would you just read that again for us, Galatians 5, 22 and 23?
Certainly. A reading from the book of Galatians, chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law.
No law. It's freely given. And then that famous verse we all know by heart. And let us say John 3:16, what a time to be saying this verse. You know, Good Friday, 2 days away from today. Let us all together unmute and repeat the John 3:16 verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You notice when God gives, he gives his best. He doesn't hold back. You know, in Trinidad, we have a say, you're chinking on me, you know. But he gives it all. Yes, Hadley?
I was thinking of Paul's talk with the Corinthians when he was complaining about the thorn in his flesh. said, but God said to me, my grace is sufficient.
It's sufficient. And I think we're going to repeat that verse sometime coming up soon. So the next thing we want to talk, can a person earn the grace of God or work for it or purchase it?
Nope.
No. No. It's too precious. You can't earn it. It's priceless. You can't pay for it. You know, and it's freely given. All we have to do is believe and receive it. Partly, I think I gave you Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 to 8.
4 to 8. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come, he might show how the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith.
Mm.
And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God.
This is not our own doing. It is the gift of God, freely given. Reverend Joseph, would you read, unmute and read Titus chapter 2, verse 11 for us?
Yes, Dad. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men.
You know, that's the other thing. It's to all men and women. When the Bible says men, it includes women, to all. The Jews had this problem in those days when they, you know, they were kind of, they think they were special. You know, and then Hitler thought his race was superior. And up to today, people are still, well, I'm better than you. You're so black, and you're so skinny, and you're so ugly. But God doesn't look at the outer. He looks at our heart.
God.
And he doesn't save the body. He saves the soul. The soul. So, what about you? Have you received the grace of God?
Yes.
Have you received the grace of God?
Many times.
Many times.
Many times.
The ultimate, the ultimate gift. That's the question. The most precious gift. We receive a lot. Every day we get the sun shining, rain falling, all of little things come, you know, in our place, opportunities, kind of these things happen that we go, wow, I didn't know that. Thank you, Jesus. But the ultimate gift, eternal life. Some people know about it, you know. But do they believe it? And have they received it? That's the question. Have you received it? Do you believe it? Do you believe without a doubt in your mind? Let me finish this question. Do you believe without a doubt in your mind that when you die, you're going to go to heaven and be with Jesus? I've hardly read for us that he will raise us up to sit with him in heaven. Do you believe it?
Certainly.
Certainly. Eh? Hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
Praise the Lord. Because there are a lot of people who don't believe it. Don't even think about it.
And there are even Christian denominations, one or two that I know, who don't believe that.
Yeah, hardly.
I believe that if we believe that, we will fashion our lives to be always in God's favor.
Amen.
We'll follow his word, we'll follow his deed and his lead where he wants us to go.
Amen. You know, Jerry, I gave you Romans 8:28.
There we go. Romans 8, verse 28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose.
And it's only by his grace that when we are suffering, when we have no money in the bank account, when our children are calling us, when our people are, that by his grace alone, that we would know all things happen for the good. It's his grace that allow us to do that. And when we receive, you know, when I was growing up in the village, in the country, when people plant crops in their backyard or their front yard and it bear, what would they do? They don't keep all for themselves. They share with their neighbors, don't they? Remember those days? I mean, they don't do it anymore. They put it on a table outside and they have to pay for it now. Kind of deal. But when we were growing up, you know, if somebody have a guava tree in the backyard, you can just go pick guava. You know, it was free for all. And that's grace. When you
there are some people by me here who are still doing that. You will drive past and you will see a table on the roadside with tomatoes and different things, and you can stop and take for free.
Is that the rule or the exception?
Well, there are a few houses. Then remember, I live among Amish people. So
okay.
They have a different culture.
Exactly. A different culture. Right. But the point I'm trying to make is we receive the grace of God, the most precious gift. This is not something to keep for ourselves, but to share with others. And God is going to give us opportunity. We just got to be aware. And please do not assume that the people who you know that they have received it like you have. It's better to confirm and ask, have you received the gift of Jesus Christ? And what a time, what a season to ask that question. And Jesus said, don't worry what you're going to say. Go, go. You received it, give it, share it. Don't keep it for yourselves. Share it with others. Simple to you, believe without a doubt in your mind that when you die, you're going to go to heaven. That's the most important question we can ask anybody, not just our loved ones, but anybody who the Lord put in our space. Share it. So, how does a person receive the grace of God? How do we receive it? Any ideas? How did you receive it?
By being faithful to God, his word, and to the teachings and everything about Jesus Christ.
Okay, so you did it. You were being faithful. Okay, Hadley?
I'd be genuine in your prayer.
Be genuine in your prayer.
Ask for it, you will get it.
Ask for it in your prayer.
And believe that you will get it. It will almost be always yours already.
All right. Ask for it. Anybody else have any ideas? How do you get this thing?
I'm saying ask for it while you're praying.
Ask for it. Well, let me tell you my story. I grew up in the church, very active in the church. I used to preach when I was in Trinidad. So I knew a lot about the word. But I did not know or didn't even think about heaven and when I die, that where am I going to go? It was not until I came to this country in September 1998 in Houston, Texas, I met this pastor named Dr. James Bland III. And he was the first one to ask me that question. Do you know for sure, Lincoln, that when you die, you're going to go to heaven? And people, I couldn't answer, yes, I think so. And he explained to me the reason why Jesus came and that what he did on the cross for us. And he taught me, I became a deacon in his church, and he taught me evangelism explosion. And that was the time when I came to realize, without a doubt, that when I die, I'm going to go to heaven. And a lot of things that my mother told me when, you know, she's one of her favorite sayings was, my reward is in heaven. And I didn't put any meaning to it while she was saying that. But after, now I realize, you know, like, you know, in that verse that says, now you see it dark as through a glass, then you will see clearly. That's what's happening. And every day you seem more clearer and clearer and clearer. Otherwise you stay in the word. So how do we receive it? We ask for it, but we got to know it exists and it's available. You see, that's the thing. And that's our role. You and me, our role is to let people know that this great gift is available. Because if they don't know, how are they going to ask? And if they don't know how to get it, somebody has to coach them and teach them how to get it. So I give Donna Matthew 7:7.
Yeah. Reading from the book of Matthew, chapter 7, verse 7. Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you.
Ask, but you got to know what to ask for. You could, and hardly Mark 11:24?
Yes, Mark 11:24. So I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours.
Believe and receive. That's why, you know, when we pray, say thank you before you get it. Have you ever tried that? Thank you, Lord, before you receive it, because you believe it. You believe it. You trust him. Thank you, Lord, for giving me your peace. Thank you for the help. Thank you for lowering my blood sugar numbers. Thank you for giving my friend Franklin peace and comfort during this time and for healing him. Thank you for healing Sharon and Andrea. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Before we even receive it, ask, believe and receive is one of my favorite statements in my own self. And I'm giving to believe and receive. That's all we have to do. So it's there, available. It's there, available. But we who have received it, I think we, it's not an obligation, but a kind of a duty to share it with others who don't know and who have not yet received it, who don't even know that it exists. So how, we talk about and we share, how does a person receive the grace of God? Is it possible to fall out of grace of God? Is that possible?
Yeah.
How will that happen? How does that happen?
When you sin.
When you backslide. When you backslide.
When you backslide, yeah. And the flesh is weak, we say. All Romans, I think, what is it? Romans 3:28? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All. So it's quite, and we have so much example of men in the Bible and women who turn away from God, who fall apart, who backslide. You know, the famous example that comes to my mind is David, King David, who is the only man in the Bible that said, the Lord himself said, had a heart for the Lord. So it's quite possible that we could fall out of the grace of God. Who did I give? I can't even read my own handwriting. Matthew 32:15. Reverend Joseph, did I give you that?
Noted.
Matthew 32:15.
Noted.
Beatrice, I gave it to Beatrice. No,
you give me Numbers.
No. Oh yeah. Numbers 32:15.
Okay,
right. Yeah. So, go
ahead. Reading from Numbers 32:15. For if ye turn away from after him, he will yet again leave them in the wilderness, and ye shall destroy all this people.
See what happens when we turn away? And then Reverend Joseph, Isaiah 59:1-2.
Yes, Jed. Surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear, but your iniquities have separated you from your God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear.
People, you know, there are some people who live their life and say, well, God will forgive me anyways. I might as well do it. If it feels good, do it. But there's a verse in the Bible, it just can't come to the text, which said that does not give us the freedom to sin. That knowledge, that forgiveness does not give us the freedom. That's the devil at work there. And there are consequences. When we break the law, we have to pay the price, right? So the time they say, well, I did some research and came up with the 11 consequences of sin. The first is it makes you worthless in the eyes of the Lord. He can't look upon sin. He can't. And then the second is we lose his presence. He turns away. He can't look upon. Remember on the cross? When all of our sin came upon Jesus, what did he say? My God, why have you forsaken me? Because the Lord is so pure, he can't even look upon the sin. And then it leads to captivity. We become obsessed, become addicted to the sin. We become a slave to the sin. And then it leads to death. Unrepented sin leads to death. And then it leads to eternal damnation and an eternal separation from God. And then it makes you an enemy of God. And we read about that earlier. And it brings curses upon you and on your generations. And it brings diseases. And sin leads to eternal destruction. Think about Sodom and Gomorrah. Think about the flood, the great flood. And it brings misery, uncomfort, stress, anxiety. And those are the 11. And when I send the review notes for you, I will include that in the reverse. So there is consequences. Jerry, read Psalm 116, verses 6 and 7 for us.
Reading Psalm 116, verses 6 and 7. Be at rest, the Lord protects the simple-hearted. When I was in great need, he saved me. Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been good to you.
So there is hope when we fall apart that we can return to him. And then Beatrice, Psalm 40, verses 1 to 2.
Psalm 40, verses 1. I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings.
And that's, you know, the David confessing, repenting of his sins and being restored. You remember the parable of the prodigal son? When he came back to his father, he repented and come back. So that's our hope. And again, that's grace, forgiveness. But we have to come to our senses and we have to return to him and seek, repent and seek his forgiveness. That's our part in the whole thing. So, what is the relationship between grace and salvation? Is there a relationship between grace and salvation? Anybody?
Yeah.
Yes.
Salvation is a consequence of grace.
Okay.
Put it out there. In other words, the grace, God grants you grace that makes you eligible for salvation.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anybody, you know, else?
Somebody read a verse with it earlier on, grace and salvation. I can't remember the reading.
Okay. The thing, and Hartley kind of nailed it. Without grace, there's no salvation. Without grace, we cannot save ourselves. We need grace that comes from the Lord. We need grace and salvation belong together as cause and effect. The cause is the sin. Yeah. The effect is the salvation. And, you know, it is, we read it earlier, it is by grace you have been saved, not by your works, not by being good deeds, but by grace you have been saved. So, yes, some people say, well, I don't need any salvation. I'm not a kid. I'm not a murderer. I'm not, you know, I might make a little thing here and there, but a sin is a sin, as we know. And some, but I don't need grace. I'm a good man. I go to church every Sunday. I pay my tithes, and they put it in a checklist, you know? But in their heart, oh my goodness, Jesus referred to them as vipers. But we all need salvation, so we all need grace. Hartley, would you read 1 Corinthians 15?
Before I do that, I have here a listing of the aspects of salvation. And it goes something like this. There's election. There's one's calling. There's repentance. There's faith, conversion, justification, regeneration, adoption as children of God, and grace. These are all the components that lead us to salvation.
Thank you.
Okay. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 8 to 10. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me.
Amen. Amen. And we know the story of Paul, blinded on the road to Damascus, blinded to his way. And then when he got back his sight to the way of the Lord, by grace, you know, God is not an Indian giver. When you receive it, it's given to you. So Hartley just mentioned one of the components of grace is justification. So Parker provides three connections to grace and justification. The first, he said, grace is the source of the pardon of sin. Justification is the truly dramatic transition from the state, listen to this, from the status of a condemned criminal awaiting to a terrible sentence to that of an heir awaiting a fabulous inheritance. Wow, I mean, so well put. Donna, would you read Ephesians 1:7 for us?
A reading from the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace.
Amen. In whom? In him. And then the second point he makes is grace is the motive of the plan of salvation. It's God's motive, it's God's intention. That's why he sent Jesus to save us. By grace, our conversion and salvation is no accident. It's no accident, but an act of God which had its place in an eternal plan to bless us with the free gift of salvation from sin. So, Reverend Joseph, read Ephesians 2, 8 to 10 for us. And listen to that verse 8 again.
Yes, dear. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast, for we are God's workmanship, created in the Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do.
And hardly Philippians 1:6.
Philippians 1:6. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ.
Our Lord finished what he starts. I tell you, one of the most powerful victory statements ever made was on the cross. Jesus' last word on the cross was, "It is finished." What he came to do, he finished. So on the 3rd, he says, grace is as the guarantee of the preservation of the saints. So our future is assured. There's no doubt. Jerry, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, please. Jerry?
Reading from chapter 1 of 1 Peter. Yeah. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Okay. Because I'm seeing some break in transmission on my screen.
We're hearing you. Go ahead.
Verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
New mercy, a living hope. And then Beatrice, Philippians 1:29.
Philippians 1:29. For unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake.
And he gives us the grace to suffer for his faith. Amen? Amen. You know, and then think about how do we respond to this grace? What comes to mind? How do we respond to this free gift of grace? How do we respond?
Thankful.
Thankful, yeah?
Thankfulness.
Be very thankful.
Confession and thankfulness. Yep. And not about seeking God's help to keep on the straight and narrow.
Exactly. You know, like Psalm 51, I would like encourage you to pray that Psalm. When David said, against you and you only have I sinned. And he said, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. Do not turn your back away from me. So how do you respond? Yes, Hartley?
You know, because sometimes we try to make excuses for what we do. Rather than admitting that, look, I didn't see it that way.
Yeah.
I was wrong. I'm willing to change it. And this is what impedes our path to salvation.
Because remember the God that we learn that he's the all-knowing God. We can't hide from him. We might fool people. We might even fool ourselves, but we can't fool him. So we need to be, and Gary said it too, be obedient to his commandments. Do whatever, oh man, that verse just embedded in my mind. Do whatever he tells you to do. Amen? And share. That's how we respond. Share it with others. What does the Bible say about if one sinner repents? What happens?
There is joy in heaven.
They're rejoicing. Rejoicing in heaven. Yeah. Rejoicing in heaven. Amen?
Big party.
Yeah.
So hallelujah.
Does the grace of God allow us to continue in sin? Again, we talk about this a lot already, and we all agree, nope. But Donna, I gave you John chapter 8, verse 11.
Yeah. A reading from the book of John, chapter 8, verse 11. She said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more.
That's the go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. And what did she do? What did she do? What did the woman at the well? The woman at the well. What was the first act?
She was the first evangelist. She went and told all the fellow villagers of what Jesus, this man, had told her.
Yep, and Reverend Joseph. Reverend Joseph, would you read Luke 10:37 for us?
Yes, sir. The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him.
Oh, Lord.
Mercy on him. You okay, Donna?
Yeah, I was just yawning a lot. The kind of tired.
And well, okay, we're coming to the end. We're coming to the end. Hartley, James 2:17, please.
James 2:17. So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead.
It is dead. His grace is sufficient to give us the power, the knowledge, the wisdom to serve, to speak up.
Yeah, as we spoke of the Apostle Paul in several of the readings before, you know, he suffered and endured a lot in all his missionary journeys. Jail in Philippi, people beating him, running him out of the city, and so on. But what sustained him is grace and his love for God.
Amen.
And his desire to spread the message, you know.
Amen. You know, in wrapping up this session, how do we share? And almost, I think all of you have been to the sharing the gospel message. So this is just a quick reminder. By our words, our kind words, the tone of voice, you know, by our good deeds, we hardly just read James 2:17 for us. By all your example. What's the example you're sharing? That, remember that ripple effect? That ripple effect?
Yeah.
And then by giving God all the glory. Some people tend to take it for themselves. Well, I did this and I did that. But without his grace, we can't do anything. Mm-hmm. There is a song I want to play for you in closing tonight. But before I go there, anybody have any closing comments? And Hartley, I'm going to ask you to close us in prayer tonight.
Okay. All right.
Any closing comments? Or are you tired and sleepy? Okay, let me play this song for you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead. We're listening to the music.
Okay. Come on.
Yeah, we have a blank screen.
I know that. I'm trying to advance the screen. It's not, oh, there it is.
Yeah.
I've seen shame, the kind that comes from mistakes, the kind that won't go away. When I turned around, they were right there to remind me. I've seen regret, the kind that messes with your head, the failures and the can't forgets. But standing here now, I'm thanking God it's behind me. 'Cause I've seen nail-scarred hands reach out and wipe it all away, yeah. Now I see grace, hallelujah, I stand amazed. I'm staring at an empty grave and the stone that you says I don't deserve what you did on the cross, and he's right, 'cause I don't, but you did it anyway. I see grace, hallelujah, I stand amazed. I'm staring at an empty grave and the stone that you rolled away. When I was prodigal, you saw, son. When I left the 99, you saw the one, and just like staring at an empty grave and the stone that you rolled away.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, yeah. Okay. I see grace. We find what we look for. Let me repeat that. We find what we look for. If we look for the grace and the blessing, we're going to find it. But we have a way of looking at the troubles and the trials and the tribulations. Look to Jesus when they come, and look for the grace and believe it and receive it. Next week, we're going to look at chapter 14, with the title of the chapter is God the Judge. So Hartley, would you kindly close us in a word of prayer, please?
Let us pray. Almighty and gracious Father, we thank you once again for bringing us together, for giving us that strength and that guidance to look at another important aspect of your attributes. Your grace is sufficient for us.
Mm-hmm.
Cleanse us as we go through our days. Drive away from us the thoughts of negativity and the acts of evil. Cleanse our souls that we may be able to follow your will and your word. Pour upon us the graces which you think we deserve, that our lives may shine forth as examples for others, so that when they pray for their grace, you will grant them. We can do nothing without you, nothing without your grace. Our lives become meaningless without your help and your support and your grace. Let us be mindful of your power to grant the desires of our hearts. Let us continue to seek you so that we will be strengthened to do your will and to see what you have for us to do each day. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, your Son. And now as we go to our beds, to our rest, re-energize us so that we may be able to bring others to you tomorrow. Those who we meet in our conversations, in our movements around, in our colleagues at work, in our social gatherings. Let them see in us the grace which you have bestowed upon us. And now may the grace of you and your Son Jesus Christ be always with us, and grant that we may be worthy examples of your love and of your compassion and mercy, that others may see the light, your light shining through us, and come to accept you as God and Savior of this world. We ask these things through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And amen. 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 Well, have a good night and see you next week. Have happy Easter.
Same to you.
Remember, Hosanna in the highest.
Yep.
Thank you. And same to you.
Thank you.
Holy and blessed Easter to all.
Amen.
Reverend Joseph.
Thank you.
Blessed Easter to you. God bless.
Happy Easter.